Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar Academy. Displayed are the list of news articles taken for today's analysis and their page numbers in different editions of the newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes in the PDF format and the timestamping of the discussed articles are provided in the comment section and also in the description for the benefit of viewers. Now let's move on to the analysis of first news article. This news article is with reference to Supreme Court's verdict on virtual currencies, which it delivered yesterday, that is on March 4, 2020. A three-judge bench of the Supreme Court has delivered this verdict. The verdict is for two writ petitions that are filed. One is a writ petition filed by Internet and Mobile Association of India. And along with this writ petition, the Supreme Court clubbed another writ petition filed by few companies that run online crypto assets exchange platforms. And this second clubbed writ petition also include representation from the shareholders or founders of these companies, and it also included a few individual crypto assets traders. These petitions have challenged the regulations of RBI on virtual currencies. So in the context of analysis of these news articles, we'll discuss the regulations imposed by Reserve Bank of India, and we'll also discuss the Supreme Court verdict of yesterday. The syllabus relevant for the analysis is highlighted here for your reference. See, RBI has declared a statement on virtual currencies on April 5, 2018. It stated that entities regulated by RBI shall not deal with, shall not provide services to any individual or business entities which deal with or settle virtual currencies. And it asked those regulated entities which already provide such services to those who deal with virtual currencies to exit from such a relationship. On the subsequent day, that is on April 6, 2018, RBI released a circular. By exercising powers under Banking Regulation Act of 1949, RBI Act of 1934, and Payment and Settlement Systems Act of 2007. This circular is specifically about prohibition on dealing in virtual currencies. While the declaration on April 5, 2018 is just a statement of RBI, this circular is a regulation of RBI. This circular directed the entities regulated by RBI not to deal in virtual currencies. Secondly, it directed the entities not to provide services for facilitating any person or entity who deal with virtual currencies or who involve in settling virtual currencies. So if there is a relationship, it asked the entities to exit within 3 months. And therefore, the regulated entities of RBI were prohibited from giving services such as maintaining accounts, registering, trading, settling, clearing, giving loans against virtual tokens, or accepting virtual tokens or virtual currencies as collateral, or opening accounts of exchanges that deal with virtual currencies, etc. So this prohibited those who operate or those who trade in virtual currencies from getting the access to banking services. If we closely observe the circular, we can find that RBI did not impose a prohibition on use of virtual currencies or trading in virtual currencies. That is, other than the regulated entities, any private player can use virtual currencies or trade in virtual currencies. So what the circular actually did, it actually ring-fenced the regulated entities from dealing in virtual currencies and not to provide services for those who involve in virtual currencies. So now let's see why Reserve Bank of India is actually against virtual currencies, particularly by private players. Here you should note that according to an anonymous person who is credited for the emergence of Bitcoin as a virtual currency, who is Satoshi Nakamoto, virtual currencies are meant to kill the demon of a central authority. And by bringing such a virtual currency, a new electronic cash system that could be owned by everyone and that could be spent anywhere has to be built. And under this currency, a central authority, say for example for India, RBI is not required. With these kind of objectives behind the development of cryptocurrencies or virtual currencies, RBI clearly stated that these currencies, they pose challenges in the form of regulatory risks, legal risks, operational risks, then risks of consumer protection, risks in data security, and these currencies go against global money laundering rules, and there will also be tax evasion, and significantly it will impact one of the very important roles performed by RBI, that is management of monetary policy. And when we say money laundering, this also includes the risk of terrorist financing as well. And because of these reasons, RBI is against virtual currencies by private players. In December 2016, RBI acknowledged that many central banks around the world, they have already started examining the feasibility of creating their own digital currencies.
If you take countries such as United States, Switzerland and Canada, they already have ATMs for virtual currencies. So as a step from the government, in November 2017, Government of India constituted an inter-ministerial committee. This committee was constituted under the chairmanship of Secretary of Department of Economic Affairs with three other members. One of them is Secretary of Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology, then Chairman of SEBI and Deputy Governor of RBI. The terms of reference is to study the issues related to virtual currencies and to propose specific action to be taken in this matter. And this inter-ministerial committee submitted its initial report in April 2018, by the time when RBI has released the circular, along with a draft bill known as Crypto Token and Crypto Asset Banning, Control and Regulation Bill of 2018. What this inter-ministerial committee initially recommended was to have a specific legal framework, and it considered that a ban on virtual currencies might be an extreme tool, and it felt that required objectives pertaining to virtual currencies can be achieved through regulatory measures. But what happened to this 2018 bill is not known. However, within a period of 1 year, the same inter-ministerial committee suggested a fresh bill, and this bill is called as Banning of Cryptocurrency and Regulation of Official Digital Currency Bill of 2019. This report was submitted in February 2019, where it finally recommended a complete ban on private cryptocurrencies. So the draft of this 2019 bill, it had a proposal to ban the mining, generation, holding, selling, dealing in, issuing, transferring and disposing or using cryptocurrency in the territory of India. And it also suggested to create a digital rupee as legal tender by the central government in consultation with RBI and to recognize any official foreign digital currency as foreign currency in our country. So if you see right now, the steps taken by Government of India in this regard is almost based on this second or latest report by Inter-Ministerial Committee. But we know that till now we don't have such a bill. If the recent bill would have become an act, then by now we would have had an official digital currency in India, and RBI or the Government of India would have the monopoly in creation and circulation of the virtual currencies. But this does not happen. So with this background, let's see what the circular actually did. See, it cut the lifeline of banking and financial services for those traders in virtual currencies and for those who run virtual currencies exchanges. And we also know that RBI did not ban dealing in virtual currencies for those agencies other than its regulated entities. So in such cases, private firms and individuals, they would have invested or they would require investments in adopting for trading in virtual currencies. But what happened? Because of RBI circular, these firms or individuals or virtual currencies exchanges, they could not receive any banking services from the regulated entities of RBI. And these petitioners, they said that this prohibition on enjoying right of banking services, it violated Article 19(1)(g) of Indian Constitution. And we know that Article 19(1)(g), it ensures that all citizens to have right to practice any profession or to carry on any occupation, trade or business. So if this right has to be exercised, access to banking is necessary. And right to access the banking system is actually integral to the right to carry on any trade or profession. And it is said that access to banking is equivalent of supply of oxygen in any modern economy. And we also know that carrying out trade or business in virtual currencies is not banned by a legislation or is not banned by RBI for other than the regulated entities. In such case, denial of such banking services is not a reasonable restriction, and it is also extremely disproportionate. This is one major reason adopted by the Supreme Court to strike down the RBI circular dated 6th April 2018. Now let's see the next main reason why the court struck down RBI's circular. See, this is because of lack of evidence or lack of appropriate conclusive research to say that the regulated entities of RBI will be at risk if they deal in virtual currencies or if they provide services to those dealing in virtual currencies. See, RBI has been involved in studying about or learning about the risks involved in virtual currencies since 2013. This is because way back in 2013 itself, RBI has been warning or giving preemptive measures about risks associated with dealing in virtual currencies. However, even until now, it has not quantified or it has not said how much risky will it be for its regulated entities. So the Supreme Court observed that RBI has not so far found in the past 5 years or more the activities of virtual currency exchanges to have impacted the regulated entities adversely. That is, RBI has not found that the activities of virtual currency exchanges will impact the regulated entities in an adverse manner. So in this case, it is not proportionate to have reasonable restriction to prohibit regulated entities from providing services to those who deal with virtual currencies. So based on these two reasons, Supreme Court has set aside or struck down the RBI circular. In the order, Supreme Court has also asked RBI to issue a specific direction to one of the public sector banks in India, which is Central Bank of India. This is because this public sector bank, Central Bank of India, has actually froze the account of one entity that operated a virtual currencies exchange. This entity is called as Decidium Internet Labs Private Limited. This entity, actually because of RBI circular and because of the actions of Central Bank of India, it became non-operational, and an amount of around 12 crores lying in that account also got frozen by the action of Central Bank of India. If you see the RBI circular dated April 6, it also states that regulated entities should not provide services such as maintaining accounts as well. Maybe Central Bank of India would have taken action under this particular provision. So what the Supreme Court ordered RBI is to issue directions to Central Bank of India to defreeze the current account of this entity and to release the funds lying in the account completely with interest at the applicable rate. So this is the verdict of Supreme Court. So what the verdict actually means is now banks can give banking or financial services to those who deal with virtual currencies and also to those who run virtual currencies exchanges. Supreme Court observed that those who run virtual currencies exchanges received a deadly blow because of RBI circular. And setting aside of the order also means that banks may now deal with virtual currencies as well. However, there are two possibilities. Most probably sooner, we can expect a legislation mostly banning virtual currencies by private players. Or least possibly, we could also have a legislation that regulates the atmosphere of virtual currencies, wherein set of entities, though private players, could also operate this virtual currency. This matter will be in discussion for more time, as it is understood that government is still not very clear on what to do with virtual currencies. So as a result, the news article in the business page states that the Supreme Court's verdict will offer only a temporary relief for the virtual currency investors and businesses, because soon, through a legislation, government may ban all private cryptocurrencies. Meanwhile, NASSCOM has stated that it does not believe in banning virtual currencies as a solution. Rather, it suggests to adopt a risk-based framework to regulate and monitor cryptocurrencies and tokens. It implies that let there be cryptocurrencies by private players. Most probably, government will allow only a state-issued cryptocurrency to operate within the territory of India. So these are the information with reference to the analysis of these news articles. We saw about the statement of RBI dated 5th April 2018. Then we saw about the circular, the regulation of RBI dated April 6, 2018. Then we saw what the circular aimed to do. We also saw RBI's idea of risks in cryptocurrencies. Then we saw about the verdict of Supreme Court in this analysis. Now let's move on to next article. These news articles discuss about the proposed linking of Godavari River with Kaveri River. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of these news articles are highlighted here for your reference. See, way back in the year 1980, the then Ministry of Irrigation and Central Water Commission, they formulated a National Perspective Plan for Water Resources Development. This plan was formulated to harness or to effectively optimize or utilize the water resources in our country. And this National Perspective Plan for Water Resources Development, it envisaged inter-basin transfer of water, where water from surplus river basins will be transferred to deficit river basins to optimally utilize the available water resources. So this will help in raising the irrigation potential in our country and will also help in generating additional hydropower. And other than these benefits, this will also help in flood control, navigation, water supply, and also with respect to fisheries. And this National Perspective Plan, it has two components. One is Himalayan rivers development, and the other is peninsular rivers development. If you see Himalayan rivers development, it deals with construction of reservoirs in the tributaries of River Ganga, River Brahmaputra, and also it involves transfer of surplus water from eastern tributaries of Ganga to the west, and it also involves linking of Brahmaputra and its tributaries with Ganga and its tributaries. And and the Himalayan rivers development also includes linking of river Ganga with river Mahanadi as well. Now coming to peninsular rivers development component, let us focus today on one of the parts of this component, that is interlinking of Mahanadi, Godavari, Krishna and Kaveri rivers and building storages or reservoirs at potential sites in these basins. So in this context, we also need to know about National Water Development Agency, which is also mentioned in this news article. See, this National Water Development Agency, it is an autonomous society that was set up under Societies Registration Act of 1860. This agency was established or set up in the year 1982. It comes under Ministry of Jal Shakti. See, the functions of this agency has evolved with the requirements of the central government. In the initial periods, this agency was asked to study the feasibility of the links under peninsular component of National Perspective Plan. Then in 1990-1991, it took up the studies of Himalayan component also. In 2006, this agency started to deal with preparation of detailed project reports of link projects and also to deal with preparation of pre-feasibility reports or feasibility reports of intra-basin links, which are proposed by the state governments as well. So the functions of National Water Development Agency has widened in the long run, and the functions of this agency is displayed here for your reference. So now let us look at the interlinking of Mahanadi, Godavari, Krishna, Kaveri rivers and building storages at potential sites in these basins. See, this part involves interlinking of major river systems where surpluses from Mahanadi and Godavari are intended to be transferred to the water required or water deficit areas in the south through Krishna and Kaveri rivers. So for this proposal of interlinking, 16 feasibility reports were initially planned for linking rivers. And as you can see, 14 feasibility reports were already prepared except two. And for those for which feasibility reports were prepared, the next stage is preparation of draft detailed project report, shortly called as DPR. And today's news article discusses about linking Godavari River from Inchampalli or Janampet barrage with Grand Aniket in Kaveri River. So the plan here is to divert waters through canal and pipeline. For this purpose, a draft detailed project report has been prepared by National Water Development Agency. And this deals with three linking projects to take water from Godavari till Grand Aniket. So the surplus water of Godavari River, either from Inchampalli barrage or Janampet barrage, will be conveyed to Nagarjuna Sagar Dam on Krishna River. This is the first project or first link. The second link is from Nagarjuna Sagar Reservoir to Somasila Reservoir in Pennar River. And the third link is from Somasila Reservoir to the Grand Aniket in Kaveri River. So the proposed alignment will pass through rivers that are located in between Swarnamukhi, Aranyar, Palar and Ponnayar rivers. And the National Water Development Agency has prepared this draft detailed project report and has sent to party states in March 2019 itself. And as per the draft DPR, about 247 TMC is planned to be diverted from Godavari to Nagarjuna Sagar Dam for lifting the river. And this water will be further diverted to the south for meeting the demands of Krishna Basin, Pennar Basin and Kaveri Basin. The news article states that apart from Andhra Pradesh, Telangana and Tamil Nadu, four other states are also involved in this river linking project. They are Karnataka, Odisha, Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh. And of these seven states, Karnataka, Odisha and Telangana, they are yet to provide their views on draft detailed project report. And once their views are received, a final detailed project report would be prepared as soon as possible. And once the statutory clearances are obtained, the project will start. So from this news article analysis, you have an idea about the proposed river links. We'll have more clarity on this area provided the final DPR is prepared and released by the National Water Development Agency. In this context, we also recently heard with reference to interlinking of rivers project in the state of Bihar, where river Kosi is to be interlinked with river Mechi. And we know that river Kosi is an international river that originates from Tibet and reaches the northern plains of Bihar state. So under the present proposal, what they are planning is to extend the eastern Kosi main canal up to river Mechi, which is a tributary of river Mahananda. So by this, irrigation benefits will be accrued to the water deficit Mahananda Basin command districts in Kharif season in Bihar. And we also know Ken Betwa interlinking project, wherein surplus water from the Ken River in Madhya Pradesh is to be transferred to the Betwa region in Uttar Pradesh so as to irrigate to Bundelkhand region in Uttar Pradesh so as to irrigate this drought prone region. So with these things discussed, now let's move on to the analysis of next news article. This data point reflects the present status of the Treaty on the Non-Proliferation of Nuclear Weapons. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this article is highlighted here for your reference. So first, let us discuss in brief about this treaty. See, this treaty is against nuclear proliferation. This means the treaty is against the increase of nuclear weapons, or it is against the increase of use of nuclear energy for non-peaceful purposes. It came into force in the year 1970, and the applicability of this treaty was extended for an infinite time period in the year 1995. So it prevents the spread of nuclear weapons and weapons technology, and it promotes cooperation in the peaceful uses of nuclear energy. As of now, around 191 states or countries, they have joined this NPT treaty, and know that India is a non-signatory to this treaty, and so is Pakistan and Israel. The reason why India is not a signatory to this treaty is because this treaty is discriminatory in nature. This is because the treaty divides the countries in the world into two categories called as nuclear haves and nuclear have-nots. The permanent members of United Nations Security Council were designated as nuclear weapon states, that is, they can possess nuclear weapons, whereas all other countries in the world, they are not called as nuclear weapon states. And Article 1 of this treaty, it prohibits transfer of nuclear weapons or transfer of nuclear explosive devices or control of such weapons from nuclear weapon states to non-nuclear weapon states. And Article 2 of this treaty prohibits any non-nuclear weapon state from manufacturing or acquiring nuclear weapons or other nuclear explosive devices. And one another criticism with this treaty is that there is no fixed timeline in this treaty so as to eliminate nuclear weapons. So as a result of these reasons, India did not sign this NPT treaty. Know that India did not sign NPT treaty because it is discriminatory, and India did not sign comprehensive test ban treaty because that treaty is ineffective. So now let's come to the news article. This article states that in last 50 years, this NPT treaty has achieved a lot. And during the Cold War period, where the Cold War was between USA and USSR, at that time, both these nations were in the race for nuclear weapons. In 1986, when the Cold War was reportedly at its peak, the world had around 70,000 nuclear warheads. But as a result of this treaty, it has been brought down to around 14,000 by the year 2019. Former US President John F. Kennedy said that there will be around 10 to 20 nuclear states because of the necessity of nuclear weapons of various countries to have such weapons. However, if you see at present, the nuclear weapon states in general in the world is limited to 9 countries. As we know, under NPT, legitimately 5 members of UN Security Council who are permanent members and 4 other members including India, Pakistan, Israel and North Korea. And it is found that while US, UK and Russia have reduced their inventories over the year pertaining to nuclear warheads, France and Israel have relatively stable inventories or numbers. Whereas China, Pakistan, India and North Korea are found to increase their nuclear warheads. This trend is seen as a worrying trend. Whereas the warheads with US or the Russian Federation, individually they may be having more than 6,000 nuclear weapons. And out of the 14,000 nuclear warheads in the present world, around 9,000 warheads are action ready to be operated. And the remaining warheads are waiting for dismantlement. And of these active warheads, around 1,800 warheads belonging to US, UK, Russia and France, they are on high alert, which means that they can be used on a short notice. This shows that the world is still under a heavy nuclear threat. And at present, Russia is having maximum nuclear warheads in the world to the tune of around 6,490, which is followed by United States, which has around 6,180. And North Korea is reported to have a minimum of 30, and India around 140, and Pakistan more than us to the tune of around 160. And China has around 290 nuclear weapons. So with respect to this, the entire South Asian region is also considered as a most volatile region in terms of nuclear warheads. These numbers are based on the sources from Arms Control Association, which was founded in 1971. This information is based on the sources from US Department of State and SIPRI, which is Stockholm International Peace Research Institute. Now let's move on to the analysis of next news article. This news article states that the volume of recycling of e-waste in our country has become doubled in the year 2018-19 when comparing with 2017-18. In the context of analysis of this article, we'll see what do we mean by e-waste, then we'll see why there is a need to recycle the e-waste, and we'll see the status of e-waste in India in the world, and we'll see few provisions with respect to recycling in the e-waste rules of the country. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. So what do we mean by e-waste? See, e-waste simply means discarded or rejected electrical and electronic equipment. These could have been rejected totally or in part by a consumer or by bulk consumers, and it also includes rejects from the manufacturing process, refurbishment process and repair processes. Examples of e-wastes include personal computers, laptop computers, telephones, television sets, refrigerators, washing machines, air conditioners, etc. And note that e-waste also includes components of these electronic and electrical equipment. There are two main reasons why we recycle e-waste. One is that it is found that e-waste, they contain substances such as heavy metals, plastic, which are hazardous in nature and which can lead to major environmental problems that will affect the human health. So if we recycle these e-waste, there will be less deterioration of environment and human health, and there will be less accumulation of e-waste in the landfills. And recycling of e-waste substitutes or it replaces the requirement of fresh resources for the manufacturing of or for the maintenance of electrical and electronic products. So thereby it acts as saving the resources. And rules pertaining to e-waste are released in India by Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change under the Environment Protection Act of 1986. Earlier, there was e-waste management and handling rules of 2011, which came into effect in May 2012. However, in 2016, Ministry of Environment brought in e-waste management rules 2016. And this 2016 rules has superseded the e-waste management and handling rules of 2011. That is, at present, e-waste rules of 2016 is valid, not 2011. And some of the important features of 2011, such as responsibility on producers, consumer, bulk consumer, collection centers, dismantler and recycle, was maintained in 2016 rules as well. However, in the 2016 rules, it has been expanded even to manufacturer, dealer, refurbisher and producer responsibility organization. The extended producer responsibility, which was introduced in 2011 rules, is still there in 2016 rules. However, in 2016 rules, the Central Pollution Control Board has been given the responsibility to ensure pan-India implementation. And it was stated that the 2011 rules failed in bringing appropriate collection targets for the producers, and it also exempted micro and small industries. One of the new arrangements with 2016 rules is the producer responsibility organization. See, this PRO is a professional organization that is responsible for collection and channelization of e-wastes that are generated from end-of-life products. Such an organization is authorized or financed by producers individually or collectively to share the responsibility. And one significant improvement with respect to 2016 rules over 2011 rules is that 2011 rules were applicable only to electrical and electronic equipment that are listed in Schedule 1. However, 2016 rules extended the applicability to even components, consumables, spares and parts of electrical and electronic equipment, in addition to those equipments that are listed in Schedule 1. It has also fixed e-waste collection targets under extended producer responsibility. Recently, in 2018, the 2016 rules were amended. The e-waste collection targets under extended producer responsibility were revised. So as a result, the producers are now liable to collect only 10% of e-waste in 2017-18 and 20% in 2018-19 and 30% in 2019-20 and so on. And we can see the 10% increase every year until 2023. After 2023, the target has been made to 70% of quantity of waste generation as indicated in the extended producer responsibility plan. In the 2011 rules, the dismantlers and recyclers, they have to obtain authorization and registration separately. Whereas in 2016 rules, in a single system, registration or authorization for dismantling and recycling units is provided. And as we saw already, earlier manufacturer was not given any responsibility for recycling. However, in 2016 rules, even manufacturer is responsible for channelizing e-waste for recycling purposes. This is also the case even for refurbisher. While there is no provision for responsibility of state government in order to ensure safety, health and skill development for workers involved in dismantling and recycling operations in 2011 rules, this has been ensured in 2016 rules. So these are some of the information pertaining to the analysis of this news article from the rules. The news article states that out of total tons of e-waste generated in 2018-19, around 20% of them have been successfully recycled. Earlier, this rate was 10% in the financial year 2017-18. This shows improved recycling rates of the country and several efforts taken by the central government, state governments and consumers, bulk consumers, manufacturers, producers have played a positive role in the improvisation of this recycling rate. And 2016 rules play a very important role, and even CPCB, which ensures pan-India implementation, is said to have a significant role as the recycling rate has doubled within a year. Now let's move on to the analysis of next news article. This news article is about the assessment report of Delhi Minority Commission with reference to the recent Delhi riots. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. We know that since the coming into force of Citizenship Amendment Act of 2019, there have been protests in various parts of the country, particularly in Delhi. Though it was observed that in many places the protests were peaceful, in few places violence is reported to have erupted. And almost in all places wherever there was violence, media reports suggest there is alleged involvement of persons belonging to majority religion in the country. And in Delhi, particularly in the last 2 weeks of February, there were riots in the northeastern Delhi. Media reports mentioned that these riots were incited by few members holding offices in the parliament, and the riots is reported to have killed more than 45 people and has imposed serious damages physically and materially. In this context, the Delhi Minorities Commission has looked into these riots and has come up with an assessment report. So we'll see few information pertaining to Delhi Minorities Commission and to have an in-depth understanding with respect to National Commission of Minorities. We request viewers to watch 25th November 2019 analysis. On that day, we have discussed about minority communities in India, the composition of National Commission for Minorities, important functions of this commission. Then we also saw about constitutional rights guaranteed to minorities. While this is at the national level, some states like Andhra Pradesh, Assam, Bihar, Karnataka, Maharashtra, they have state-level minority commissions as well to protect the interests of persons belonging to minority religions. And the Union Territory of Delhi also has one such minority commission called as Delhi Minorities Commission. This commission was established by the Government of National Capital Territory of Delhi. It is a statutory body as it was set up under the Delhi Minorities Commission Act of 1999. Similar to National Commission for Minorities, its objective is also to safeguard the rights and interests of minority communities in National Capital Territory of Delhi. And know that when we say minority community, here we are referring to those communities notified by the Government of India as per the provisions of National Commission for Minorities Act of 1992. And as we know, in India, persons belonging to Muslim religion, Sikh religion, Christianity, Parsi, Buddhist and Jain communities, they are declared as minority communities in India, and the same also is applicable to the National Capital Territory of Delhi. We can go through the functions of the commission, which is represented here in this image. And one of the functions is to look into specific complaints regarding deprivation of the rights and safeguards of minority communities and to take up such matters with the appropriate authorities for necessary action. But what we have to know here is that this commission is just an advisory or a recommendatory body, meaning whatever orders it gives, it is not binding on the government, but will be given a due importance by the government authorities. And the assessment report of Delhi Minority Commission has reported that most damage during the Delhi riots in northeastern Delhi was done to shops and houses belonging to persons following Islamic religion. The commission stated that the riots were one-sided and well-planned with support from local people as well. And only in some places, the shops and houses belonging to both Hindu and Muslim religious communities were affected. And this assessment report has also stated that the announced compensation by the Delhi government is inadequate considering the extent of damage that happened during the riots. So these are some of the important information pertaining to the assessment report of Delhi Commission for Minorities. And as per the article, the commission has also stated that it will form a fact-finding committee that comprises of journalists, human rights activists and civil society members. And the report of this fact-finding committee will give a clear picture on the extent of damages that happened during Delhi riots. So these are some of the information with reference to the analysis of this news article. Now, this comment of the viewer is with reference to who is the founder of Chisti Silsila in India. On 1st of March 2020, we discussed about Urs festival in Ajmer Dargah of Khwaja Moinuddin Chisti. We have made a statement that Chisti Silsila was established by Khwaja Moinuddin Chisti. The viewer has asked us to clarify with respect to who founded this Chisti order generally. And there is a confusion that whether this order is founded by Sheikh Bahauddin Zakaria and that it was brought to India by Moinuddin Chisti. First, let us see few information about Khwaja Moinuddin and Sheikh Bahauddin. See, as per government sources, Khwaja Moinuddin was born in 1141 AD in Chisti in Herat in Afghanistan. So that is why the name of the order is Chisti Silsila, which is a place in Herat province of Afghanistan. Recently, we saw about Herat military base when we studied US Taliban peace deal on the same day. Some books say that Moinuddin Chisti came to India around 1192 AD and he passed away either in the year 1235 AD or in the next year 1236 AD. Now, if you come to Sheikh Bahauddin, he was born around 1170 AD after the birth of Khwaja Moinuddin. He was born not in Chisti in Afghanistan, but in Multan in Pakistan. So one thing we can clearly say is that he is not associated with Chisti Silsila. Rather, he is an important Sufi saint in the Suhrawardi Silsila. He passed away in 1262 AD. So while the Suhrawardi Silsila was founded by Sheikh Shihabuddin Suhrawardi, historical studies say that Bahauddin and Jalaluddin Shuposh Bukhari, these two individuals are credited with introducing Suhrawardi Silsila in India. Now come to who is the founder of Chisti Silsila. Some historians say that it was founded by Abu Ishaq Shami in around 930 AD. But in India, it was reportedly introduced and established by Khwaja Moinuddin Chisti. So here when we say Silsila, it refers to a Sufi order, which is a lineage system having continuous chain through which successive spiritual caliphs or heirs, they traced their spiritual inheritance to the founder of that order. We have given you other important Sufi orders in our country and the area of operation for your reference. Now let's move to next comment. See, this comment is with reference to the discussion on 3rd March 2020. The viewer asks whether Turkey share border with Azerbaijan or not. See, the answer is yes. Turkey shares border with Azerbaijan. This is because though Turkey does not share border with mainland territory of Azerbaijan, it shares border with an autonomous region which is a territory of Azerbaijan. The name of this autonomous region is Nakhchivan Autonomous Region. So therefore we say that Turkey shares border with Azerbaijan. Now let's move on to the practice questions discussion session. This question is a previously asked question in Prelims 2015. They have given 5 countries, asking which among the above are nuclear weapon states as recognized by Treaty on the Non-Proliferation of Nuclear Weapons, commonly known as Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty. All the 5 countries possess nuclear weapons. But as per the NPT treaty, only 5 countries in the world are recognized as nuclear weapon states. These are countries which are permanent members of United Nations Security Council. They are US, UK, France, China and Russia. So the correct answer for this question is option A, 1 and 2 only. This question is with reference to Delhi Minorities Commission. They have given 3 statements asking which of the statements given above are incorrect. First statement, it is a statutory body established by the Parliament under the National Commission for Minorities Act 1992. Now, this statement is partly correct. While Delhi Minorities Commission is a statutory body, it was not established by Parliament under this NCM Act of 1992. It was established by the Delhi Legislature under Delhi Minorities Commission Act of 1999. So once you are confirmed that statement 1 is incorrect, you can eliminate option 3. Now the second statement, it has declared only Parsis, Jains and Buddhists as minority communities in NCT of Delhi. This is wrong because it considers all the 6 minority communities in India as minorities in NCT Delhi. They are persons belonging to Muslim religion, Sikh, Christian, Parsi, Buddhist and Jain communities. So the second statement is also incorrect. So you can eliminate option A. Now come to third statement. It is chaired by Union Minister of Minority Affairs. This statement is incorrect. This is because the chairperson of Delhi Minorities Commission is appointed by Delhi government from persons of eminence, ability and integrity, and from persons belonging to minority communities of Delhi. So all the three statements here are incorrect. So the correct answer is option D, 1, 2 and 3. Here in this question, they are asking which of the above substances are present in electrical and electronic equipment waste. Arsenic, cadmium, lead, polychlorinated biphenyls, silver. See, all these substances are found in e-waste. If you take arsenic, it is found in semiconductors, diodes, LEDs, solar cells, etc. If you take cadmium, we can see this in batteries, circuit boards, computer batteries, etc. And if you take lead, we can see in lead rechargeable batteries, transistors, lithium batteries, lasers, etc. If you take polychlorinated biphenyls, they are found in transformers, capacitors, and silver is found in switches, batteries, resistors, and capacitors. So all these five substances are part of e-waste. So the correct answer is option D, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. In this question, they are asking which of the following rivers are peninsular rivers. They have given Tapi, Pennar, Vaigai, Mandovi. They have given Tapi, Pennar, Vaigai, and Mandovi. See, all these rivers are peninsular rivers. Tapi River drains in Arabian Sea, flows through Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra, and Gujarat. Pennar River drains in Bay of Bengal, flows through Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh. Vaigai River drains in Bay of Bengal, flows through Tamil Nadu. Mandovi River, also called as Mahadai River, also called as Zuwari River. We discussed about this river and Kalasabanduri project on 29th February 2020. It drains in Arabian Sea and it flows through Karnataka and Goa. In Goa, it is called as Mandovi River. So the correct answer for this question is option D, 1, 2, 3 and 4. With this, we come to the end of today's The Hindu News Analysis and the practice question discussion session. If you like the video, click the like button, comment, share and subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates and content on civil service exam preparation. We'll see you tomorrow.